London calling to the underworld. Come out of the cupboard, you boys and girls. London calling, now don't look to us. Phony Beatlemania is putting the dust. London calling, see we ain't got no swing except for the rain and the crunch of things. The ice age is coming, the sun's zooming in. Meltdown expected, the rut is going thin. Engine stuck on him, but I have no fear.
Good afternoon, everyone, and thank you for joining us today. Our next session is a panel about creating conversion, developing an effective customer conversion strategy, and customer focus. It will be moderated by Firas, Samko from Dyson, who will shortly introduce our panel of experts. We'd like to remind our attendees that they can send questions throughout the discussion, and the speakers will try to answer them. Now, can I please ask Firas and our speakers to turn on the webcam and microphone? Perfect. Without further ado, Firas, over to you.
Thank you very much for the introduction, and thank you everybody for tuning in. So we have so much to cover today. So without further ado, we're just going to jump into a quick round of introductions, starting with you, Layal.
Hello, Firas. Hello, everyone. So my name is Layal. I'm the regional director for Modanisa for MENA region, US and Europe.
Gustavo, we'll go with you afterwards, if you don't mind. We're going the alphabetical order.
Yes.
Hi, everyone. How are you all doing? Pleasure to be here. I'm Gustavo Smidt, Chief Product Officer at Namshi.
Kedar.
Hi, everyone. My name is Kedar. I'm the Vice President for Zomato for the Middle East region. Great to be here.
And Majed, last but not least.
Hi, everyone. I'm Majed Tahan. I'm the co-founder and MD of Danube and Bin Daoud Applications. Nice to be with you.
Everybody for tuning in as well today. So we have so much to cover, as I mentioned earlier, and I think it's a long-awaited session from everybody that's tuning in, also from the audience. So just a quick reminder for the audience to drop in your questions throughout the whole session, and we'll try to cover them as well as we go through. So ladies first. So Layal, this first one is for you. We often talk about conversion customer experience as one of the key pillars when it comes to furthering conversions. So with that in mind, in your opinion, what are the main drivers of a high conversion rate?
Well, Firas, let me just define it in three factors. I think the first factor is the moment that the visitor comes to the website, he's still not a customer. So it's really the importance of the content itself, and then how to maximize the content for this visitor to convert it into a customer. I think this is the first factor in my view. The second one is how much this visitor is attractive to our brand and to our offerings. And this is where we connect the customer to the value proposition of the company, right? So do they find that this is interesting for them? This is what they are looking for when they visit a website. And the third one is definitely, as we all know, the platform itself, whether it's a UX, UI, the speed, this is obviously falls within the platform as a one key factor. So I think it's really a combination that we can talk about. Conversion rate is a broad discussion. And I think we have to just look at it from different angles as well.
Okay, fair enough. And then you mentioned something around the brand specifically, and Gustavo, onto you on that. So I know that that at Namshi you focus a lot on the brand or the brand image specifically. Would you like to elaborate a little bit more on the correlation between the brand and the actual conversion rate?
Yeah, I mean, so trust is a big element around conversion rate. So the more trust you have, the higher the likeliness of, you know, customers giving you their credit card and trusting that you'll deliver on the promise. So having a strong brand will increase trust and increase the conversion rate 100%.
And Kedar, in your experience and being in the region for quite some time now, what is the impact of that trust? So it's like following on from Gustavo's point, what is the impact of that trust and what have you seen in the recent years?
I think trust, of course, is super critical to kind of, you know, step one to creating that customer conversion. I think for us, you know, Zomato primarily is a content platform because that builds the trust. So we invest a lot of time and effort in providing very rich, accurate information to the user. And we realize that the more information that we give with, you know, a lot of clarity and you know, richness, the trust builds further and further. So for us, trust is the first thing that we think of building when we build the customer experience journey.
Okay. And then following up from something that Layal mentioned as well, and onto you, Majed. So we were talking about the technical bit, right? So all the technical tools that are basically used in order to further that conversion rate. And based on your experience in AYM or either with Danube Online, what do you think are some of those basically tools that are used in order to really improve that conversion rate and create a high conversion rate?
Okay, so we use a lot of tools. The most important thing is how seamlessly these tools are integrated with each other. You could have a very strong CRM tools and very strong marketing tools, but you don't have the people that operates them quite well. So we discovered that the more you analyze the data, the higher the conversion rate is. People are looking for a customized experience. They're looking for something that really talks to them. You cannot just have, you know, like generic marketing campaigns or generic offers. These don't convert quite well. So the more you analyze the data, the more conversion rate you will have, the higher the conversion rate is. So discoverability also is very key for us. We have a lot of SKUs that we show, and we tend to make these SKUs very easy to reach for our customers. So again, we have a very strong data team. We mine the data quite well. And with this, we feed our tool, we feed our different marketing tools. With them, we can actually generate a tailor-made, you can say, marketing promotions that really helps and improves our conversion rate.
If you allow me to dig deep a little bit more on the data part, because it's quite an interesting topic, and I think the audience would be very much interested to know, what are those different types of data sets that you would basically be looking at, or type of KPIs, metrics, et cetera, that you will be looking at in order to inform your conversion strategy?
Okay, that's a good question. Actually, we create different funnels, and there are different types of SKUs that triggers a customer to be inside this funnel. So let's say you are a customer that always buys organic products. So you'll be put in a funnel that caters for customers who actually like to buy organic products. So this will be a different segment of customers. Customers who always buys fat-free food. So it will be another funnel. Customers who are allergic to gluten, you know, you can have gluten-free also. So the more funnels you have, and then you can also depend more and more on your tools to automate these campaigns. So you cannot actually have a very well automated campaigns if the data are not fed in the right funnel. So if you spend time and effort on putting these customers in the right funnel, then system will do the rest. But if you don't spend time on funneling the people right, then you will be sending promotion to someone who doesn't care about gluten-free products. You'll be spending time and effort sending him gluten-free promotions, but he will not transact. So you put time and effort behind the tools, you segment your client quite well, and then system will automate and do the rest. So that's why it's very important to have a very strong team that understand these behavior. And then the more you use and the more you operate these tools, you set different triggers that segment the client in a different funnels.
Okay, and you brought us to like a very interesting topic, which is more around the funneling or basically the shopper journey. And then Gustavo, I'm addressing you with this. We often talk about lead conversion, and we talk about like it's basically an obsession in our line of business, right? It's our bread and butter. And we also often talk about basically either solid CRM programs, or we talk about great customer experience, as in a digital journey customer experience, or even we talk about turning customers into retained shoppers on our platforms. Let's zoom in on the customer experience specifically, and then specifically around the digital customer experience. So here, referring a little bit more into the journey that shoppers go through on your websites. What are, in your opinion, basically the ingredients of a top-notch customer experience?
So it has to be very, very easy to use. So don't make users think. So they need to be able to basically click and get what they want. So it has to be effortless. It has to have the necessary payment methods. So that there's a few things that you need to understand the user and add whatever feature or payment provider or whatever they're expecting. So you have to have a good framework to improve the customer experience. So in building iterations, using a data feedback loop, understanding what moves the needle for them, and then build on that. So of course it can be very, very different depending on the industry. I mean, if in fashion, the main drivers for conversion rate, you can have a subpar customer experience, but if you have a great selection and you have great availability and great price, people will sell and they would struggle a little bit. So our job is to basically, get the experience out of the way. So make it just smooth and unnoticeable.
And then in the apparel business, so Layal, how do you see that as well in terms of the journey that that shoppers would go through? And again, coming back to the question, what do you think is a top-notch customer experience? So what are basically the ingredients or things like boxes that you need to tick in order to have a perfect customer experience?
Yeah, I mean, I think I look at it from two pillars. One of them is the new customer, the acquisition, and the other one is the repetitive customer, so your retention customer. When it comes to the first part, which is the acquisition, obviously what they don't know us yet, so it's this first time they experience the website. These USPs that you make it very visible for them are important. For example, MENA is a highly cash on delivery market, right? So this is something very important to highlight for this visitor once they are on your website. For instance, in Europe and US, they care more about the returns, that you have an easy return process. So it's important to highlight it. And then for the retention, they tried you already. They have their expectations and they just need to keep that expectation in place. And you need to literally, higher than expectation all the time. So we look at it from two pillars, and on different region, it obviously it differs a little bit. But what I would say is, regardless of these two, customer experience is key. And I always link the customer experience to the customer satisfaction, because this is where your customer, it's a word of mouth, right? They will start telling about your brand and making it more valuable for other customers who have never tried you or maybe had a bad experience with you. So jumping on the customer experience to improve conversion is very important. And this is really, I think internal stakeholders in the company have to be aligned on the importance of the customer experience and the customer satisfaction, and the conversion rate will be then seamless. So personalization or localization is obviously something that we do in order to make you feel that we know what you want, how we segment our customers and the funnels that we take them through it and the journey itself. But obviously the buy-in of all the stakeholders is very important to maximize the experience.
So you mentioned something very important, which is personalization. I would like to dig a little bit deeper on that with you, Kedar. So basically, your business is predominantly very much reliant on CRM initiatives, basically to build up your database, et cetera, and focused on retention as well. And you were among the pioneers in terms of also personalization in the region, not necessarily as a Zomato, but that whole industry of the services that you offer today. So can you elaborate a little bit on the importance of CRM and then the data element of it, and then the development of that persona, of that digital persona, and the link with the personalization of service?
Sure. So I think everyone mentioned some really key points over there. I think number one is, of course, understanding the friction points in the buying journey. I think data gives you that visibility. A lot of times, I think we focus a lot on positive feedback loops, but truly the answer sometimes lies in the negative feedback loops. Like, why is somebody not building their cart? So, in our product, the first thing we look at in terms of personalization is the choice of restaurants that we show to you as a user. And, cohorting is the right way of kind of bucketing your user set you want to show the right set of supply or restaurants to the user depending on their life cycle. So that's step one in terms of personalization that we kind of apply. We kind of marry that in terms of your life cycle and time of day, because, you know, food is a use case that happens 3 to 4 times in a day. So I want to make sure that I show you a choice basis your either historical buying behavior, if I have that, or, you know, depending on where you are in the life cycle. From the friction points, I think what we understand is, you know, the food buying also is a very visual experience. We make sure we layer a lot of images and content along with that. And I think from the personalization front, you know, we look at price sensitivity as a very key segment. So we bucket our users into maybe 4 cohorts: upmarket, mid-market, budget, you know, and we try and show promotions to those who it really makes sense. You know, we've actually seen that if I show offers to people who are not very price sensitive, they actually buy lesser. So we do that segmentation and make sure that we show promotions the right way. And yeah, I think then of course, I think for us, just making sure that we keep increasing through personalization the user's frequency of purchase, I think that is something that we kind of, you know, layer. And CRM, of course, eventually is the tool. So once you've got your cohorting done and you know what is the the track the customer is on, you kind of use CRM as a conversation channel to keep building on top of that buying journey that they have.
Mm. So Ahmed, sorry, Majed, you were the first one to open up the whole data topic today. So I'm gonna get back to you on this one with the personalization element, specifically on with zooming in a little bit on like Danube Online and the experiences that you're trying to create within the market. Can you just elaborate a little bit more on the element of personalization and how do you do that focus basically around personalization, and how do you ensure that your communication with your consumers is to what they're actually expecting from your platforms?
So as per what has mentioned, there are people who are not price sensitive, and it's totally right. When you actually give them a promotion, they tend to transact less. We've seen this. So the more time we spend on data analysis and the more time we spend on building our funnels, as Layal mentioned as well, is when building a funnel, you have to build a customer journey within this funnel as well. So there are people who actually transact in a different way, and they are bucketed and funneled in a different customer experience as well. So we also do to monitor a lot our promotions. So we execute a campaign, and we analyze the result out of that campaign, and we use this as a benchmark for the next campaign. So if you're building a campaign every day, and sometimes we do flash deals, like we do a deal for like 2-3 hours, and out of which we gather all the data and we analyze this data, and then we find the do's and the don'ts in this campaign, and we try to make the second one actually more successful than the previous one. So if you're doing this for a pretty long time, your team gets quite well at it, plus the tools will be really strong. So the more you analyze, the more you study, the more you look at your customer data, the better results you will have. Plus, we also look at the feedback that we get through our different tools of communication, like emails, like live chat, like WhatsApp. Also, we do have a WhatsApp channel, and we hear our customers. We talk to our drivers. That usually is the touch point between us and the customer. Customers sometimes convey a message to the delivery guy, to the driver who's actually dropping the groceries in your house. You send a message to us through him. So we also try to always be in touch with our drivers, always be in touch to our pickers, packers. The store pickup feature also, there's a very big touch point between the customer and us in the stores as well, because we do have the store pickup feature as well. So when we put all these together, it will become really, really a strong back end that is serving your customers. Again, we tend to do every quarter. We invite our customers for a session, a workshop, and that we sit and brainstorm together with them. Sometimes you can actually believe in a feature or believe in a promotion or a campaign, and then when you launch it, you get disappointed because the results are not as you expected. So you have to really listen to the customers, listen to the people on ground, and because of these are the main source of information that we have, not only the tools, not only the system, not only the behavior of the customers on the platform itself, but you have to actually touch point with the customer, whether it's through the actual driver or through the different channels of communication as well.
All right. And here I'm going to jump to you back, Gustavo, on a point that is related more to customer retention. So we all have in our own businesses that aim of ensuring that that shopper that's landing on our websites is not a bad passing shopper. It's not an opportunity that they're just grabbing at the moment. It's basically a longer relationship that we're trying to build. Now, there's so many, obviously, there's so many ways that we could work out a scenario where we incentivized our customers to be retained. In your opinion, what are the different programs or technologies out there that our audience today on this call would be interested in to know about in order to increase that customer retention and increasing the customer lifetime overall?
So the first is fairly simple. So there's a mathematical formula to happiness, which is happiness equals reality minus expectations. So if you smash their expectations with your experience, then they will be very happy customers. So delivering fast and in good manner is super important for loyalty. So you have to have the right tools to deliver fast, and the right carriers and the right operations. And then of course, make sure you know your customer and you keep on improving the product around what you learn from them. Showing them more relevant search results, showing them more relevant communications with your CRM. It's fairly simple. It's about the process and having the right focus.
And in your opinion, how do you basically ensure that you retain these customers and then you build a lifetime experience with them versus just addressing their need at that specific moment in time when they actually visited your website?
Yeah, so you need to continue improving the experience as you learn from them. There's no tool or silver bullet. It's a continuous effort to try to make the experience more seamless, to remove blockers, and to deliver fast, and have good prices and the right selection and the things that really move the needle. So you need to understand what moves the needle for them.
And Layal, what is your take on that when it comes to customer retention? So what are the different tools or technologies or mechanics that you think would be applicable in order to ensure retention of customers as well?
Well, for the retention customers specifically, a robust CRM system is very important. And I would definitely, and what we do really well is we look at the journey at every touch point and we evaluate it very carefully. It all starts from the awareness moment up until the prospect conversion, and then it goes to growing our customers and retaining them. So this is a funnel, really, that customers go through. At every touch point, you are at a risk to lose a customer. For instance, market conditions change and you are not on top of your game, or you have competitor activity that is more seamless than what you have, or maybe you have the speed of the website or your application. So really for the retention customer, I think the best thing that we do and we can do is listen to these customers. Those people that they come and they complain with our customer service or our social media, for instance, they are telling you something. They are telling you that we care about you, we love your brand, but just improve this inconvenience, for example. Or they will tell you something about the product itself, that they are expecting another set of product. And remember, retention customers, they have a very high level of stickiness to your brand. So the new things that you show it to them are important. Wherein for acquisition, it's completely different. The whole thing is new to them. So for the retention, I would say definitely CRM is your big thing. Connecting the cohorts together is very important. Customer lifetime value is a key. We can see today in many e-commerce businesses wherein a higher percentage of customers, they only convert the first order. And I think this is where we look deeply into this data at every touch point, why they are not converting, how can we retarget them in a very healthy way, because bombarding them also is not really there. So the more segments you have, and the more you know your customers' behavior through your CRM, the better communication, conversion, and then bringing back this customer that we have lost throughout the way. So this is how I see it, really. I think the only tool for retention is mainly the CRM, a robust CRM system.
Okay, and I'm going to jump to you, Majed, but Kedar, I'm going to get back to you with a question that we got today as well around the omni-channel strategy, and then the how we tackle it. Basically, I don't know if it's an opportunity or a challenge for Zomato, but then we'll figure it out in a second with you. But Majed, I'm going to jump to you on basically the technology element, and here I'm referring a little bit more onto your AYM experience. So basically, there have been leaps in our industry today when it comes to the role of big data, artificial intelligence, advanced analytics, et cetera. And in order to basically help companies or help firms, help websites to be much more customer experience centric. Based on your experience and then your exposure, either with Danube Online or with AYM, with helping other businesses as well accelerate in this area, What is the latest out there when it comes to technologies that can actually help in creating that customer experience?
So the most important thing here is that every company or every business has a different set of customers with a different set of expectations. So the tools are the same. You can have a very strong CRM tool, but not strong people operating it. So what we've seen is that people who are selling groceries or businesses that are selling groceries are different from businesses that are selling, let's say, clothes or high-end brands. So again, implementing these tools needs a very deep dive in the customer behavior and the customer expectation. You need to quickly be able to adapt and change your approaches to customers. We've seen that referrals are really, really good there, because referrals are like, it's a generic approach also. Loyalty is helping a lot on the retention as well. So awarding your customers and noticing them, the more they transact, the more they earn, you know, these kind of tools really helps in the retention, plus the customer experience. But again, every business has its own set of expectations. Every customer transacting with a platform has his own set of expectations. Again, we've seen also other things, that the more people transact, the more they become loyal to you, and then the higher their expectations becomes. So it's very important that you also grow your set of offerings, you grow your capabilities along with your customers. Most of the e-commerce platforms and the e-commerce businesses are relatively new. You can say 5 years, you can say 6 years, 3 years in some of the cases. So building these customers or this clientele base and growing it and keeping them with you for years and years and years, you need to be improving as well. You need to be also up to date in all the available tools. The market is evolving quite fast. The systems are changing, the codes are changing, servers are becoming more and more stronger. People are, again, expecting more and more by the year. So you can't just, you know, you need to also grow with your customers, because they will expect more. The more they transact with you, the more they expect. So again, we always advise that the company should have a very robust team that can change and adapt to the changes. We all have seen what happened recently in the entire world regarding the COVID-19 situation. Everyone had to immediately adapt to this, working from home, changing a lot of things. I mean, you used to have people on ground, now they are very limited. So if the companies or the businesses are not able to adapt with their customers or with the what's happening in the world, they will lose a lot of customers. Because customer can be sticky for a moment, for a while, for a few transactions, and then they will drop. If they're not seeing that the platform is evolving, if they're not seeing that the platform is keep offering more and more new services, new things. Sometimes we have 10 new ideas, but we actually schedule these 10 new ideas in the like 3-4 months. So people will always, customers will always find a new feature, will always find a new thing, will always find an improvement. Improving yourself with the customer is very key. Because again, it's relatively new compared to brick and mortar businesses that has been in the business for 40 years, 30 years. they're much more heavier to move or to adapt. But for e-commerce or for people in the digital world, you have to adapt quickly. You have to add features quickly. You have to even sometimes change the entire interface, drop it and implement a new one. You need to be very quick with the customers. And importantly, you need to be growing with your customer, growing with them, giving them more and more every month, every quarter, every year. It will really help the stickiness and the loyalty of the customers.
Mm-hmm. So before I jump to you, Kedar, I think credit to all of us for not mentioning COVID-19 for 30 minutes, which is great because today it's the talk of the town. So it was mentioned, Majed, you broke it already. moving to you, Kedar. So just on a couple of points that Majed has mentioned already. So regarding the technology bit, so you have been among the pioneers in the space that you're operating with today, and you've went through a lot of iterations between multiple apps merging into one app, et cetera. And at the end of the day, that has its own impact on customer experience because you're basically changing a behavior and you're expecting customers to change their behavior along with you. Can you explain a little bit more about the journey that you went through specifically at Zomato when it comes to the changes from a technological point of view and then the adaptation that you expected at least from your consumers?
So I think everyone mentioned some really valuable points, and I'm just going to kind of pick on those threads. So for us, the journey has been very interesting because when we first started out, we've been in this region for about 10 years now. And when we first started out, our consumer was on web and has slowly moved to and has actually rapidly moved to mobile. So pretty much maybe 95% of our transactions and business is happening on the app. We still leverage, I think, web a lot to kind of drive acquisition for our apps. So most of the discovery for Zomato happens through, SEO and whatnot. And people discover our product because of, what they're searching for, and they land on our page. And so we have different tracks for both platforms to make sure that we kind of optimize and, leverage both platforms. If you've noticed, the Zomato app has changed maybe 4 times every year. We keep iterating on the product. I think some wonderful points mentioned about growing with your customer, and that's super critical, because, and there's a lot of heartburn, by the way, because consumers get used to your product and suddenly you've completely changed the interface. That rating, which was in green color, is now red color. And you're suddenly confused that, wait, is this the right, metric that I'm looking at? So, but we've seen that these calculated experiments have paid off. I think before we do launch full scale, we do a whole bunch of A/B testing to just see if our hypothesis is making sense. I think a lot of our rollouts are purely on the back of A/B testing frameworks. So we've actually iterated the app multiple times. In fact, we just had our latest app change as well, and we can already sense the heartburn a little bit, but we know it's going to pay off in the long run. So one of the biggest things that I think we changed for our buying behavior for our consumer is that initially the user had to do 4 screens of checkout. So you'd see your restaurant, you'd see some ratings, you'd build your cart, you'd make your cart, you'd finally see your payment screen, and then you make the, the transaction. And we actually condensed all of that into 2 screens. So there was 2 screen checkouts. So big gamble over there, but we did it. And initially we got some feedback where consumers were like, that's too much information in one go, but we actually are now reaping the benefits of that entire kind of condensation of the app as well. So I think largely, the main drivers for us that has driven, I think, customer conversion has been this whole framework of, we call it the triple AQ score. We build on affordability, we build on assortment, we build on accessibility, and we're building a lot on quality. Especially with the COVID-19, what's happened, I think we're working a lot with our, because we're a two-sided marketplace, so we work a lot with our partners to kind of make sure that we capture information of hygiene elements that they're doing at their end and kind of position it to the user as well. So I think these are some of the broad things that have been some learnings for us over the last couple of years.
Okay, interesting. And then I'm going to try to also to address a topic that has been raised also by the audience around feedback. So they usually say, don't mess with the hungry person, right? So, and this is basically all the types of customers that you're dealing with day in, day out. So what are the different types of mechanics that you have in place in order to, one, collect that feedback or gather that feedback, and then the processing of feedback? So we heard everybody today talked about listening to your customer, but then in reality and practically, how do you do that?
So from Zomato's point of view, I think we're trying to capture feedback as often as possible, and we leverage the app to kind of capture those questions. Someone mentioned around the CSAT score. So I think the two metrics we look at is customer satisfaction, and we also look at an NPS score, a net promoter score as well. And that gives a lot of good feedback loop to the system of what we're doing right and what we're doing wrong. Most of the data capturing happens in two places for us. I think one is when the transaction is complete and an email is sent out to the user. So in the email we capture it, but we also capture a lot inside the app itself. So whenever you're when you complete a transaction, you're browsing, there'll be a little pop-up that comes in that, you know, how are we doing? You know, how would you rate your experience? So I think multiple kind of, you know, touch points are there, which help us kind of collate these two, three pieces of information.
And on the tools that you use in order to collect that information, do you use in-house developed tools, or do you actually try to source anything from what's available on the market for that purpose?
We built ours in-house.
And Gustavo, I'll come back to you in a second on the omni-channel strategy. So we'll come back to that. But Layal, on the customer feedback also, and how you collect it, and the ways you're able to manage customer feedback in general, and how you process it and how you make decisions out of it. But more interestingly, how does it differ across also different regions? Have you seen, or different markets, have you seen a different type of feedback that you get, or more markets that are more where consumers are more prone to give feedback? What is your experience on that front?
Yeah, definitely. I think the market conditions are different, and this is where the expectations of the customers are different, and this is where the feedback will come to you in a different areas, right? So, for example, in some areas, a survey is more than enough to get a good feedback from the customer, while others, it's more of a consumer focused groups where they express it better, or they feel that they are comfortable with this way of communication and transferring the feedback. Also, on Modanisa, 97% of our sales happens through the app. But obviously, we have it, as Kedar said, that we have also the acquisition that first they come to your website and then they go to the app, right? So that there is this transition. So on the app itself, when a customer spends more than maybe 90 seconds on a product itself, that is something that they cannot find it there. So the content maybe is not there. So that's a feedback that we gather. The time spent on each product, the time spent at the checkout, the bounce rate, apart from the feedback, the customer give it to us through different channels, right? Whether it's a survey, whether it's a, let's say, customer service, live chat, any other method, like the standard method. I think it's important to look at the metrics itself while customer is browsing, and I'm trying to understand why this customer spent long time on the checkout and literally spent around 10 minutes to select the item. So they are in the stage of converting, but then they stopped at the checkout. So this is another feedback that we can collect through the data. So we look at it from different angles, different regions. Like for example, in Europe and US, it's a completely different approach of how we can gather feedback. It's through communities. So people share their feedback on communities, and we have a very strong community building in the company wherein we are very close to these communities. We listen to them. We try to understand their challenges, because they wouldn't respond really, or they wouldn't share their feedback mostly on customer service and other channels. So it differs between region, but at the end of the day, these feedback are very valuable for the company. And I think this is the next move, or the next step of adjusting the strategy in order to get back these customers' positive ratings.
Right. So Gustavo, I'm going to jump to you now, and for 2 points, I'm going to stick with you for a while. So the first one is around, it's basically a challenge to all the what we call pure online platforms these days, which is basically the omni-channel approach. There's specific ways of there's specific touch points with your consumers, and today they could be in the form of an app, of a website, etc. But then also there are other types of interactions or touch points that you could create. So for example, at Dyson, we have a demo store that is a physical demo store, but at the same time, there's an online platform that actually helps in creating multiple options for consumers. So how do you tackle that and at Namshi, and how do you create alternatives for that, for missing out on that point? Or in fact, do you actually do address it? So that's my question to you for now, and I'm gonna come back with another question to you in a second.
Yeah, thank you for the heads up. So, I mean, when you talk about omnichannel, you need to understand what are the activities that will give you the best ROI, right? So what are your lower hanging fruits? So in order to be omnichannel, you need to be first multi-channel. So you need to be online. If people are looking for your brand and you're not there, they will buy from your competitor potentially. So the easiest way to go online is through a pure player usually. Through a multi-brand like Namshi. So when brands are going on the path of omnichannel, which is a long one, passing through someone like us is a good step usually. So we can make the most of this. At the same time, whenever if you compare online with offline, in order for users to move from an experience where they can touch and feel the product and try it on, you need to be better in certain ways. Usually you're better in selection, price, and convenience, right? We do really, really well in those three. So we have a massive selection, we have really good prices, and then we deliver really fast. So but your question was more around, you know, what technologies can we have to like make the experience more on par, right? So there's a few things that we're playing with, not out yet. So I don't know if I can talk about it. But for example, size recommendations, you increase the level of trust and confidence when I tell you, okay, do you have this shoes, Nike Air, whatever, in this size? Fine, Adidas, you need to get this other size. So then you increase the trust and it's closer to the offline experience. Something similar can happen with beauty nowadays. I'm going to mention COVID-19. So in stores now, you cannot try on the makeup. So that opens an opportunity for us to bring in new tools like virtual try on and things like that to compensate for the fact that people cannot try makeup on the stores. So there's a lot of things that we're playing with.
Interesting. So you're basically, to conclude, it's basically recreating a certain experience that to some extent compensates for the lack of that omni-channel experience or that physical store experience. And yeah.
Also avoiding the gimmicks and so also it's important to avoid the gimmicks and to know what really moves the needle. You know, you can offer a lot of, you know, belts and whistles that don't drive revenue. But at the same time, you need to know what really drives the revenue, which are the things that I mentioned before.
Correct. And I'm going to shift completely to a different topic. And here I'm talking about more the creativity and the role of how creative we get in our communication, whether it was in the form of content or whether it was in the form of how we present ourselves digitally on digital platforms. So I'm going to focus a bit more on the content because I know that this is an obsession for Namshi. So on content specifically, how do you think that content actually is helping or helps businesses in traffic acquisition?
Yeah, I mean, so there's two main elements here. So one, you know, the right content brings in the right customers with a high purchase intent. So it's, you know, if you have the right targeting, your conversion rate will be higher. Usually when you increase traffic, your conversion rate tends to go down because you bring in more users that are not so high intent as the previous ones. And the second one is branding, as I mentioned before, so the trust. And with higher trust comes a higher conversion rate. So it's fairly simple. Of course, creating content is a lot of effort and a lot of testing and trying different, different messages for different users, A/B testing, and then finding what really works.
And moving away from content, as in the content that, that is hosted on websites, and then looking a little bit more on the marketing content. So by that could be visuals, copy, tone, whatever, everything that's entailed into marketing communication. So Kedar, I'm addressing you with this. At Zomato, basically, you have different marketing strategies to attract the customers into your app. Can you elaborate or at least give some guidance for the audience that's here today on the importance of creativity in order to acquire that traffic?
Sure. I think the creativity angle is, you know, a great way of kind of showcasing your brand's values and kind of what kind of stand for your brand personality. I think Zomato has always tried to play a very fun, brand as such. We're always trying to portray that, whether it's the way we leverage our, you know, social handles, the way we kind of do gamification on the platform itself. We also do a few offline experiences where we get some foodies together as well. So I think the first step is to just understand what does the brand kind of stand for? What are some values? What are some kind of personality traits that you want your kind of audience to kind of pick up on? And then kind of, you know, build a plan around that. Some of the quirky things or some of the meaningful things that we've done at our end, which have, you know, paid off in terms of the brand positioning. I think one has been that, you know, whenever your screen is loading on the app, you know, normally you get like a little circle of like buffering. Instead of having that buffering image, we actually put in small, food puns or some food historics that no one knew about, you know, like where was this invented? And people actually screenshot that and put it up on Twitter or social media saying that, wow, you know, Zomato, pretty cool. Another thing that we try to do from our side, you know, from a creative point of view is, we wanted to bring a more human, because we care about our riders, you know, so we wanted to bring a human touch to our delivery experience as well. So when you order on Zomato, often you will see the photo of the rider and a small write-up about the delivery pilot himself. And, you know, that just makes it a bit more kind of, you know, personalized for the person who's ordering. And you'll see that consumers really appreciate the extra mile that we go through to kind of build in more creativity into the entire buying journey. So for us, I think the whole creativity element has been super key.
Okay. And moving on to you, Majed. So you've been quite active on both website merchandising by making changes literally on a daily basis, all the way to making content updates, as well as basically being very digitally active, so on the multiple digital platforms. So how do you ensure that element of consistency across all the different touch points where you're communicating with consumers, whether it was your own platforms or whether it was the other digital platforms?
So it's all happens through our marketing team and data team. We work closely together and we monitor all the data changes very closely. We have multiple checkpoints. But sometimes mistakes do happen, but we used to actually create these checkpoints where the same team always checks the same content. We update these contents and we work closely with our suppliers as well. So, you know, when you're selling foods and you're selling these things, these actually tend to change a lot. Artwork changed a lot. Messaging around the product changed a lot. So, and if you are on different platforms and different fronts, let's say, you don't want to update one front and miss the other. So we have some checkpoints that we always check on these points before we launch or we create our new approaches or new deals, let's say.
And Layal, on to you. So do you think that consistency needs to be there to begin with? So are we talking that there has to be a consistency on different touch points, or is there wiggle room for having different type of communication every once in a while between what you're communicating and what's being communicated on digital platforms?
Yes, I think to start with, like, content is king, right? So this is where we can position it in a very few words. In Modanisa, we have 130 countries. And if you go from one country to another, you will see different content. So we have literally a machine of content production on the marketing side, on the design side, and then obviously on what we are writing on these banners and communication. And these are very important because if I'm not attractive to a banner, to a design, to the wording that you are putting on this content, on this banner, I'm not gonna click on it and I'm not gonna continue my experience. So for us, this whole idea of the mockup is very important. And we know really also that using a very strong content on digital social platforms are very important, especially when we talk about video content, for example. Like, it has a very high conversion because people feel it like it's more alive, right? So it's more close to them. What we can say about really the content itself is this is a very important treasure that we really need to look at, optimize, and be very creative around how we can target it more, how we can improve it better. But linking it to the digital platform and then making sure that this message, whatever you are communicating, whether you are communicating it on your banners or your push notifications, on your CRM emails, on your social media, there is a very good consistency in terms of the messaging, and then the customer will have this in mind. We have seen it with multiple brands where I will link one word to one brand because I've seen it a lot, right? Everywhere, whenever I go, I'll see the same word linked to that brand. And I think this is something very important. For Modanisa, because we are very niche in our consumer, we are like only modest fashion. Content related to product is very important. So for example, the length of the tunic itself is very important. So this is something that we work on it a lot. We ensure that it's very clear for the customer. It's a combination of marketing content, of design, of product content, and definitely experience content. It all really improves conversion highly.
Sure. And staying with you on one other topic related to behavior or shopper behavior. So today there's this innate behavior that we have specifically around the apparel business, around browsing. So we take that from our offline experiences as shoppers, and then as online shoppers, we take that with us. And I'm sure that you face a lot of that, a challenge where you have a lot of browsers on your websites rather than people who actually are there to convert or to purchase. So, and among these browsers, there's potential leads because there's you obviously cater for that type of clientele, and then afterwards you want to convert them. So what are the major challenges? And here I'm only focusing on the challenges, not really the solution part of it. What are the major challenges that you face in order to turn leads into actual sales?
That's a very good question, Fira. So it's a completely different experience. And definitely not all the customers that come to your website, they are most likely to convert, right? Some of them, they just come and visit. The quality of the traffic matters a lot. But what is mostly important is how can I create an experience for the customer that makes them feel very comfortable for the shopping for shopping online? And this is what it's easier when you are in a shop and you're trying on, you're touching the fabric. Today, the whole idea of purchasing online is really related to the trust and the reviews that you get. And the challenges today is how we can leverage that. Sometimes the customer behavior is different. Some people like a specific kind of fitting, which they will give you a review and they will say, oh, you know what, your sizes are so big. And then others, they would like it like a more kind of slim fit. And then they will say, your items are so tight. So it's really challenging when it comes to converting a customer. But what I would definitely say is, any customer that comes in an online platform has a high potential to convert. It's like when you are in an offline store, the moment that you go to the fitting room, you are 80% a buyer, like 80% kind of chances are that you're gonna buy, and then the 20% remains on how you feel about it. Same for the e-commerce. The challenge really remain on how we can let the customer trust that this item is as you can see it. We will deliver it fast to you. You can return it easily. And obviously the quality is important, and the quality is what we highlight a lot in Modanisa.
Okay, and Gustavo, so from your experience as well, and you're trying to also answer one of the questions. So again, that browsing traffic is obviously also often turned down by what they see in terms of pricing or their comparison exercise that they actually go through. How do you understand within Namshi, how do you understand today that element of sensitivity around price, and then how do you attribute a failure of a conversion to the price sensitivity specifically?
That's a good question. I mean, so we are now in a time where there's a crisis and you would expect, you know, a higher price sensitivity, but at the same time, we our order, average order value increase, no? So price is a perception. So you can create if you create a good perception, you can get away with certain maybe not having the lowest price, but you have the highest, the best brands, the all the sizes, the selection, and you deliver very fast.
Okay, and Kedar, on to you on this point as well. So again, today it's a very common behavior in your industry as well of the element of comparison, right? Because probably the clients that you have on your platform are available on other platforms as well, and there's that whole element of comparisons that consumers go through. How do you basically attribute specifically the failure of converting to the price sensitivity? How do you see that correlation, and how do you actually track it?
I think creating affordability for our consumers is super important, and we see that moment that vector goes up, conversion also goes up. So I think creating affordability on your platform is super key. I think Gustavo made a very key point where he said that price is also a perception. So we, in the product journey itself, we try and make sure that the buyer feels great about buying that product, right? I mean, a very small thing that we've probably taken from booking.com is that there's a strikeout price when there is an offer running. So you know what the actual value is and what we're essentially, you're getting at. We do a lot of kind of thematic campaigns as well every month, depending upon the season and, the type of user you're trying to attract, which also helps in creating more affordability. And, because like you said, the consumer honestly has maybe two or three of the similar apps that we have. And what can make us different is super key. And so price is definitely one vector where we need to make sure we are giving more affordability to the user compared to other players in the market, but also the delivery experience the users actually also value a lot. So we actually invest in our own delivery infrastructure, which is our own logistics system, because we can see that the conversion of leads is higher when they're ordering on our own fulfilled order. Because consumers love the live tracking feature. They want to see the guy go into the store, pick up the food. They want to see what route he or he is taking, because eventually the consumer is also very anxious. In our industry, we have a limited window to impress and satisfy the consumer. If I'm unable to get the food to that person within, let's say, a 35 to a 45 minute window, and 45 minutes, that's very generous of the consumer, then we have won. And so I think for us, price is super important, but of course that is one vector that we look at, but the delivery experience also is very important. And we can see consumers make a trade-off. Sometimes they prefer the faster delivery experience compared to affordability as well. And that's why I think just going back to the cohorting that we did in terms of, price sensitivity, super important that we do, looking at the recency, the frequency, the monetary value of a consumer, and we kind of cohort accordingly.
Excellent. So Majed, we're a bit short on time. I'm going to be ending with you, but basically based on everything that we've heard around the challenges on converting those leads into sales, and in a couple of minutes, how can we overcome these challenges? Just in a very brief, high level, couple of pointers.
So like a note, a commitment to your customers that you will always be adapting, always be innovating, always trying to cater for their needs and to innovate new features, new services that actually come closer and closer to the customers. And through these difficult times, if you're not innovating more, working harder, you will lose the customer because someone else will do a better job than you. So although now transactions are higher, although now the clientele base is growing faster and faster than before the pandemic, but the challenges are really high. So a note to everyone, to our customers, that how can we, as you asked, how can we overcome this? By adapting, by innovating, by working harder and harder to keep on moving forward, because these difficult times comes with extremely high challenges. And if the company or the team or the everyone who's involved in the business are not adapting as for the entire business, we will lose the customers.
Thank you. Thank you, Majed. So we'll wrap up with that. Thank you for that note. And thank you, Layal, Gustavo, Kedar as well for today. I personally enjoyed the session a lot. I hope our audience enjoyed it as well. And hope to speak to you soon in another format as well.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you, Firas, for moderating the insightful session and to all of our speakers for sharing the knowledge. That is the end of this panel. The attendees can watch the next session, which is a fireside chat between Kareem and Apps Flyer. Thank you, everyone.
Thank you.
Thank you.